What I wanted to do is take the baton and then pass it forward into a marathon situation here. And because a lot of the issues we're going to be looking at are non-linear, one of the things that I wanted to kind of focus on first and foremost was clarification of a couple of terms, a couple of bullet points. And one or two of the things I was working on the other day, just to kind of recap notes for everybody, was the idea of pattern recognition being one of the kind of core elements of early 21st century aesthetics. And because pattern recognition, whether you're Google and you have search algorithms that sift through billions of gigabytes of data, or whether you're an artist or a mathematician or scientist, being able to give structure to huge volumes of information is a crucial aspect of modern life. Yesterday, one of the other things me and Mitch were talking about was this idea of perspective machines, from Euclid to Brunelleschi to even the idea of Cartesian logic. Now, how we put perspective together, how search algorithms structure the ideas and the way language interacts with the ideas that we make, well, those are things that I really try and kind of contextualize by saying that nature versus the artificial realm of human endeavor, what's the drawing point? What's the line dividing the two? Or in fact, are they divided at all? One could argue that anything humans do is natural because we're part of nature, and that nature is essentially, beyond the human scale because we're just a component of it. We're not the ones going around saying this universe is going to be like this and these atomic molecules are going to be like that. Although, amusingly enough, we're ascribing those to like godlike qualities. The creation of artificial life, blast of nuclear bombs, the hubris of these oil wells that are now being just, they actually were saying they were thinking of a nuclear option. Did you read about that one? They wanted to drop a nuclear bomb on the oil well.
The Russians recommend it. Yeah. They did it five times and it worked four times.
Yeah. Yeah, nuclear bomb off the coast of Alabama and Florida was really,
what could go wrong?
So, I'm sure you guys have heard of Dr. Strangelove, right? So, the pun here is that today I want to get everybody into this mentality of looking at art as the kind of elusive interface between the natural and the artificial. Art is something that human societies have always used to try and structure perception of divinity, of spirits in the air, or for that matter, how poetry and the idea of divine rights and all these kinds of historical motifs come home to roost. And so, to me, music is a mirror that we hold up to society. Music is never separate from society, and above all, the whole idea of art is something that is kind of a crucial thing to how society imagines itself in the order of things, in the order of the universe. There's a very famous example in India that they had this whole thing that the universe was held up by an elephant. And so if you ask, what holds the elephant up? And say, the elephant's held up by a turtle. And then you're like, okay, what holds the turtle up? And they're like, another turtle.
Turtle's always up.
So it just keeps going. But I love the fact that the society that gives that kind of beautiful view of a very lyrical chain of command, so to speak. If you were to say, all right, most modern humanity in the industrialized, post-industrialized world, what makes our universe work? You would say, quarks, muons, all sorts of quantum spectrum, all sorts of stuff. But most of us very rarely have a very deep structured relationship to that information. It's something that could easily be mythical, or it could be a story that you heard at a bar, like, hey, I heard the universe is held together with these things called quarks, Or you could be a writer named James Joyce who uses the term quarks in this story. The term actually is taken from one of his stories and applied to physics. So, art and literature are always part of the component elements of the imagination. Science usually has some relationship to the arts in one level or another. In fact, many scientists, like Einstein, for example, played music and was an artist on the side. One could argue that many of the key developments in science have been predetermined or almost pre-thought out by artists. So there's always this kind of unstable and also non-linear relationship between art and science. So what I want to do is pass out the booklets that we gave. And thanks to Jared for coming up with the Xerox scenario. Jared, just as a little follow-up, can I ask, can I ask if you could, are these collated?
Yeah, they should be.
So everybody would get...
Yeah, I could do it if you want.
Yeah, that would save time so that we can just give everyone a little chunk of all of the stuff.
Okay, no problem.
We'll pass this around in just a second.
And the idea here is that you're looking at a Socratic dialogue, something where I'm hoping that us, me and Mitchell here, are kind of ciphers, so to speak, where we can kind of set up some information and have a good dialogue about it. So what I want to do is walk you guys through a couple of my current projects as an artist and then kind of use those as an arc to get back into some of the themes that Mitchell was talking about yesterday between science, design, and contemporary aesthetics. So right now I have a show coming up at the Guggenheim Museum in New York, and it's going to be in October, and it's a project the Guggenheim is coming up with this whole series of exhibitions around what they call chaos and classicism. So let's just show you some samples. And so the Guggenheim commissioned me to do a reinterpretation of a very famous film by Jean Cocteau called The Blood of a Poet. And so basically, for Cocteau, the idea was that poetry and realism, the idea of the nature of the imagination, so to speak, or the imagination of nature or the natural, were mutually reinforcing myths. And so he felt that, you know, as if you look back at the early surrealists, if you look at the coining of the term surrealism, it just simply means beyond realism. And if you look at Guillaume Apollinaire's coining of the term, he was a poet who came up with this idea because poetry was always slightly ahead of everything else. So what I ended up doing was working with Jean Cocteau's estate, and they gave me access to a lot of his archive. And again, you have to imagine surrealism. All right, at the same time surrealism was going on, the Dada movement, the kind of vorticist, the constructivist, futurist, all these kinds of movements. There was even a woman named Valentine de Saint-Point who did this kind of project called A Manifesto of Lust, which was a dance piece where she had physics equations projected on her body in light, you know, used in around 1912 to about 1917 in Paris. It was, you know, wild project. So she was making dance choreography out of, you know, quantum, early quantum physics. So artists always try and figure this stuff out. And Jean Cocteau was kind of a central figure for these several art movements. This is a very famous photo of him, as if he's multiple people and doing several simultaneous projects. These are some stills from the film. You can see people are hanging upside down from the ceiling. It's dark, so you guys can't see that per se. And if you think about Marcel Duchamp and the early Cubist movement as well, all of these guys, the common denominator was that they were under siege, under new forms of perspective. So if you think about what's happening with the Impressionists, again, it was not just painting, it was music as well. You had Debussy on one hand versus Monet and Manet on the other. Composers, artists, writers, everybody was trying to figure out how industrialization had affected the imagination. So to me, Cocteau was one of the kind of first people to really get it. And I think that by combining film, choreography, opera, poetry, you name it, he was one of the first artists to be a multimedia artist. So when I was working with his estate for the Guggenheim, we came up with this idea of the rescore, and it's going to be in has anybody here been to the Guggenheim?
Oh, yeah.
But you guys all know the Guggenheim, right? It's a spiral, weird space inside. So we're going to have projections of this film. This is one of the considered to be the essential DNA of early surrealist cinema, even though, for lack of a better word, Cocteau always had issues with the idea of being labeled as an artist. Every artist always says, I don't want to be labeled. Like, if you tell Philip Glass he's a minimalist, he'll burst into flames, you know. So let me just play this for you. And what I want you guys to think is, first and foremost, this is a trailer, and I've taken certain moments from the film. Hopefully, it'll be bright enough. Let's just look it up. It's just going to take a second to load. Thank you. So this is going to be part of the exhibition Chaos and Classicism. And what we're going to do is, I'll just show you the other artists involved. It's a kind of pre-establishment kind of scene with the Guggenheim, because they always, you know, it's this whole, you know, it'll be a lot of heavyweights from the 20s and 30s, Fernando Gel and all sorts of different people. So this is the official Guggenheim description. But the idea of the avant-garde at the beginning of the 20th century was really overshadowed by two things. One, economic and political turbulence, because you had the whole the rise of Nazi Germany, you also had the Great Depression, and you had, above all, a deep questioning of the idea of the march of progress. So, on one hand, in the teens, you had people like the Italian futurist, a gentleman by the name of Luigi Russolo wrote a great book called The Art of Noise, Atto di Rumore. And so what happened with that time period was that noise was considered this radical departure from composition. Whereas now, of course, as we have better ears and better science, you realize noise is about complexity. It's about being able to have multiple signals of dissonance overlapping one another to the point where the human ear no longer can give it structure. But if you have the right equipment to be able to decipher what is normally considered noise, it's usually incredibly complex, very rich, very robust. So Chaos and Classicism, the Guggenheim, that's not going to be for a couple months, but I wanted to start the discussion off with Jean Cocteau and then go a little bit earlier to a gentleman by the name of Méliès. Now, Fernand Méliès is one of my favorite artists. I'm not, not Fernand Méliès, my God. A different, sorry, I'm spacing on the names here. Méliès, Georges Méliès, was a magician who essentially wanted to apply magic technique to film. So what he ended up doing was making copies of himself in his films, and he would edit them to the point where it was, again, it was kind of this layered sense of multiplicity going on. Now, the reason I'm starting with Cocteau and then going back in time to Méliès is that I want you to kind of think about some of the issues about what happens when you think about sampling and pattern recognition. So I'm going to start, this is the cover of Scientific American in 1915. You'll see this is Etienne Jules Marais, he's a very renowned photographer. What he did was essentially industrialized vision. What happens with this kind of material is that the camera's lens captures movement in a way that the human eye never could. So you can easily see how painters picked up on this. If you look at the Cubist movement, of, say, for example, Marcel Duchamp's Nude Descending Stairs, that's considered one of the best paintings of this early perspectival reconfiguration. So breaking motion into small fragments, being able to see the components of movement, was something that was a radical departure for art at the time. And again, this is from 1915, the same year that Luigi Russolo wrote The Art of Noise. So, my second book just came out a little while ago. It's called Sound Unbound. The whole idea for the book was it's 36 essays about sound and contemporary art. So I'm going to kind of go back to that later this afternoon. And the essay, Jared, that I'm going to remind you about Xeroxing, I got the senior legal counsel at Google. She's kind of a rock star lawyer. I got her to write about the idea of search engine algorithms and copyright law, because there's this huge amount of material that Google has to handle every day, but they automate it. And the search algorithm is one of their core intellectual property issues. In fact, their computers just got hacked in China. I don't know if you guys read about that. Google's just pulled out of China because that search engine algorithm is worth billions and billions of intellectual property dollars. So you realize, the 21st century, our economy has moved from an industrial to a now information-based economy, and so some of the most scarce resources of that are ideas. So, Méliès, Jean Cocteau, Orson Welles, those are three filmmakers I'm going to refer to today as sort of touchstones for this idea of looking at and sort of being uncertain about the boundaries between natural versus artificial. So what you're going to see here is a film from 1900 where Méliès makes seven copies of himself. It's called The One Man Band. So what he's doing here is thinking about sampling and applying the logic of magic to, you know, again, something that was considered realistic. Here we go.
En 1900, il y a donc presque 100 ans, Méliès représente ce qu'il était réellement dans la vie, un homme orchestre. Thank you.
reason I'm starting my discussion with both Tocqueville and Méliès is precisely that they were people who felt that magic had a relationship to everyday life. And if you go further into the 20th century, one of my other favorite filmmakers, Orson Welles, has a great film called F for Fake, where he's talking about this idea that what is an authentic object, or what is an authentic painting, or print, or design, if it's not something that's, you know, sort of condoned by the powers that be in the normal art world. So counterfeit painting, counterfeit sculpture. The funny thing is, the ecosystem that I'm referring to here is completely human. You know, we decide what is authentic, what is the authentic relationship of human beings to a system that we've already made, which is, you know, one could argue again, there's artificial logic at play. So I'm going to go from Méliès and Cocteau into two other examples. Then I'm going to show you guys probably several other kind of clips relating to this idea of nature versus artificial. The reason Cocteau and I think Méliès are very important is precisely that they opened up this idea of dream space, which is when I'm talking about dreams, the problem with, I think, 21st century is we're all very overloaded and we don't have enough time for dreams, even though one could argue. So let me skip ahead to 1945. This is a really fun clip where it's pretty much a character whose dreams have been designed by Salvador Dali. And you're going to see this idea of an unnatural landscape where the character's dreams and the idea of realism have blurred together to the point where he no longer is certain if he's in a dream state or if he's in an art piece. So the pun here is the blur between natural versus physical versus unnatural versus dream. So here we go, 1 second.
Okay.
Make skips over to this Louis Buñuel Chien Andalou, where there's a very famous scene where the guy takes his razor and slices this woman's eye. Yep. It's a very famous moment. Have you guys ever seen this?
Yeah.
Probably. Okay, most of you have seen it. So now, the reason I was showing you Salvador, the idea of dreams designed by Salvador Dali, is that he's somewhere between the other guys I was talking about, Jean Cocteau, Orson Welles, Méliès. Precisely from the viewpoint that he played with realism to the point where he would do these kind of very wild stage photos, stuff like that. Now, if we fast forward to what's going on, say, for example, right now as we speak, the idea of video testimony and realism, say, for example, the Israeli flotilla, or for that matter, the spill cam that's in the middle of the Gulf of Mexico, you can realize that perspective and how people use film to document natural phenomena, how they use it to create vocabulary that gives other people the ability to interpret data. Now, these issues are still with us, but for the most part, the idea of dreamscape versus natural or science type, situation, you're going to be seeing more and more of the use of video as a kind of full-scale representation of nature. And again, the Manhattan Project, which I was showing you guys the other day, the guy went so far as to actually reverse engineer urbanization altogether to erase the city of Manhattan from itself. So, you guys have any questions, comments before I continue on? Natural realism, art, or perspective, you guys with me on this? I have a tendency to be very non-linear. Okay, so, let's see, hold on 2 seconds, let's skip ahead here. It's fine, Mr. Your piece is still, yeah, there we go. So, when you're thinking about digital literacy, and you're kind of looking at how people think about organizing space and time, this is something that's really incredibly crucial. John Harrison is a big hero of mine precisely because he was someone who created the idea of longitude and the idea of putting the whole planet on the grid. So when you think about the British Empire in the 18th century, one of the main things that was troubling for them was getting all of the trade routes together. They were losing ships, commerce was getting messed up. So the Parliament offered a huge prize to be able to help navigate the world in any way and form. They needed a system to be able to completely mark out the world, create a structure that people would be able to navigate by. So Harrison invented the H4 clock, which is basically the idea of longitude. And that's where you get the idea of the world one time, as a very famous standard, kind of phrase from FedEx or UPS. You know, so the idea of multiple time zones, the idea of longitude, the grid applied to the world at large. So let me just show you one standard minute. The reason I'm showing this is that I got access to the clock because it's a long story. Harrison left his estate to the British Navy and the Admiralty put it in Greenwich. And because the British Empire put themselves at the center of the map, that's why we have Greenwich Meridian Time. Regretfully, it's a little faint. But what we did, this was an art project that I presented with an artist named Julian Leverdier. And we got access to the United Nations standardized world's time zones. And the idea here is that you're hearing the actual mechanism of the clock. And we put a microphone in the clock, recorded it, and made these really beautiful sound installation pieces at a couple different museums. So the idea is of standard time, standardization of time, industrial time versus atomic time. Nuclear, you know, if you think about cesium particle clocks, that's what actually makes all your cell phones when you get off the airplane, your phone becomes standardized with whatever time zone. So this is a human system that's been applied to nature, and we've tried as much as possible to put the world into these quantifiable units, the grid. Now, the reason I'm going back to these historical materials is I'm going to slowly bring it into more of a contemporary thing, ending in, believe it or not, in Antarctica, which is that's another project. But each project that I'm hopefully showing you guys gives you enough of vocabulary to then jump into other things later. So it's additive. So can most of you guys see the world? Mitchell, what are you doing?
I'm trying to close this.
Yeah, it's been faint. So what we realized was the clock's mechanisms moved at a certain BPM around 180 beats per minute because it's a full circle. It was 360 degrees, right? So if you assign each unit of time to those degrees of the turn, you get a full circle. So this is one standard minute at about 180 BPM, or if you go a little bit further to half of that, 90 degrees, right? You can see that we can easily break the world with these component grid structures. 9 degrees, 90 BPM. Amusingly enough, the tempo of most electronic music and hip-hop, jungle, stuff like that is around 90 beats per minute. And standard time that you're hearing is mechanical material. You can think of it as a sort of metronome, sort of an early idea of a quantized rhythm. So here we go. This is going to be one standard minute. So even though they're in the same time zone, they put themselves 15 minutes apart. Or China, which should be in one time zone, they have the whole country run on Beijing standard time. So even if you're six time zones away, you still have to set your clock to the same time zone. Or in the US, we have daylight savings time, which was made so that farmers can get their goods to the market in Chicago, but still have the ability to telegraph to the markets in New York. So there's a sense of humor about the way people play with standardization and then interpret it. Which is, again, it's a very postmodern impulse, really, actually. Yeah. So standardization versus variation. Above all, for the 21st century, as we look back, this idea of industrializing the landscape, creating the grid, is still part of the way we think about things. The grid is something about like time, it's about space, it's about Newtonian concepts of how we organize what they call the mechanical universe. But above all, it's now old news.
So if you fast forward to Einstein's theories of relativity, what happens in the 20th century with relativity is that everything becomes fragmented in this way that you really feel like the 21st century, we live in that kind of hyper-fragmentation. So the reason I'm giving you guys a little bit of this historical material is to kind of give it a little bit of a ground.
I just have a question. When it was in the ocean and it veers over, is that because there's islands there, or is it just because it's international territory?
Oh, that's a good question. The islands, believe it or not, over here, all these islands are colonies in the Pacific of all the European countries over here. So, say for example, if you're in French Polynesia or Vanuatu, a lot of them set their clocks to like France,
yeah.
Even though you're halfway around the world. In fact, some of them will put themselves in a little, you can see over here where they've switched the entire time zone around a group of islands.
Yeah.
That's Vanuatu and French Polynesia and a couple other ones that literally, if you go straight across the world to Europe right over here, you know, weird stuff. In the U.S., Venezuela, for example, and Colombia, even though they're in the same time zone, they've switched the times because they are slightly at war. Brazil switches around. You can see this graphically, actually, you guys can't see it. But I'm following the line of the way they've changed the time zones. Same thing in the U.S. over here. You see the lines of Eastern versus Central Standard Time. So nation states, time, the grid, okay? When you're looking at like those islands you're talking about, funny is the lines get really bizarre over here,
yeah.
You know, because people are like, we're in the middle of the South Pacific. Now, if we split this whole map over, when I was in Antarctica, the sun didn't set the whole time I was there. And in fact, all the science bases just set their clocks to whatever their home country is. So one time we visited the German base off the Weddell Icy Shelf, and the German base was on German time, and then we walked 3 miles over to the Chinese base, and the Chinese were all asleep because their clocks were set to Beijing time. And we, you know, it was kind of this weird, even though you're in the middle of a sunny, gorgeous ice field, they've set their clocks to a whole different section of the world. Now, I'm using this just as an example of relativity, post-structuralism, and so on, but the pun here is that the more we've tried to organize and quantize and set up these systems, the more complexity lends itself to all sorts of errors and redundancies and strange interpretations of the data.
If I can.
Yeah, go ahead.
Because I think this is fascinating, and you know, the more I look at it, the more I wonder in 10, 15, maybe 50 years from now, when people see this as kind of a more of an antiquated system. Some of the logic from what I remember, you know, the kind of history of the making of time and the separation of the zone of time, came from kind of graphic guy, Edward Tufte, in his book, A Visual Display of Quantitative Information. Where they were in Chicago, they were looking at trains arriving in America at various points. And it was very difficult to kind of, you know, designate and coordinate a continental-wide transit system. Trains leaving New York had to arrive at Chicago at a specific time. The New York time is different than the Chicago time. And there's always the issue of the actual light available for people to unload or you know, put cargo in or passengers want to be there on time. Anyway, so they started. I guess this is when the time zone really started to take effect. It became much more logical based on some geopolitical boundary. But now this is, you know, this is so well ingrained. I mean, you look at it globally, it's this an easy universal standard that everyone works at. When you think of Wall Street, whether you're dealing with stocks trading in New York or trading in Tokyo or wherever you are in Europe, I mean, everyone's kind of accepted to kind of manipulate their time zone and deal with everything in this kind of coordinated event. And I know I touched upon it loosely yesterday, but there is this other world that we all exist in, more or less, and that's becoming more prevalent every day, and it's the web. It seems to be highly universal. And the Swatch Corporation, years ago, I don't know exactly when, but they started promoting something called BeatTime.
Mm-hmm.
And I was talking about it yesterday, I looked at BeatTime again. It seems to be what a great way to kind of connect everyone on Earth because we're supposedly all connected to this network and do it through 1,000 beats per day. This is something that might be logical, you know, reinventing of time irregardless or irrespective of some kind of location in space, especially local issues like night and day. It's pretty big. But moving in this beat time universe, it's becoming more and more prevalent, especially when you know, we're more and more connected. I've got students having no problem sending me an email at 2 a.m. expecting an answer at 3 a.m. And, you know, we're both in New York. And this is, everyone's up at any time and you're doing work at any particular time. So it's, maybe this is something that's, I don't see it happening instantly, but there's kind of this tension in this. Maybe there's we get rid of this kind of the grid that we're seeing now, and there's this just a blanket of just one signal.
Or simultaneity. I mean, everything is going on all the time. And that's the fun thing about web time or net, the nickname for it is net time.
Yeah.
But with 21st century, so many people are, you know, looking at simultaneity as a basic practice. When I say that, I'm talking like, you're talking about your students in your email. Like for me, for example, when I wake up in the morning in New York, I already have email from Europe and a lot from Asia because I have a lot of friends and people I correspond with, like in Korea, China, Japan, and so on. Then as New York starts getting up, I get a second wave of email, usually around 10 a.m., then the Midwest and then California. So by noon, I've been dealing with email all day, you know, which is why I don't do Facebook so much, because I have these friggin' email. But the idea of simultaneity is something that's really crucial for thinking about the 20th century, because it's something that really blew everybody's mind in the arts. And the artists were all trying to figure out, if everything is simultaneous, if you're like Duchamp and you're trying to figure out, okay, I'm going to do nude descending the stair, and you're going to capture every moment of the woman walking just down the stairs, just trying to measure the time of that. Everything blurs, and the woman becomes all these small fragments of herself. Which is like, the reason I began the discussion with showing you this photograph here, Betty and Jean Parade, because all of this is simultaneous. The cameras just broke it up into small fragments in a way that human beings had never seen it before. Even though, like, if I move my arm, your eyes are putting together a small series of snapshots, basically. It's the motion of this, you know, or the way your ear hears a voice, is small, you know, like sound waves going on your basal membrane. Basal membrane creates an electrical waveform, sends a signal to your brain organizes it into sound. But the problem is it's always made of fragments. Everything is tiny, depends on your scale of reference and the way that you look at it. But what we're realizing in the 21st century, even if I'm sitting here, I'm just a huge collection of atoms. What is holding that together? Or the fact the human body is over 92% water. What's holding that together and what makes it become functional? So if you think about really, really digging into the structure of how human beings organize information, we're really pulling the whole frame apart right now.
I'd also interject that there's also resistance involved. There's somatic embodied issues with how labor operates under capital, even if it's this, you know, this virtualized system. When I was working at Napster, we would run tests for the new client system at night, and we had people all over the world accessing the server and testing out the new download client, and they were all over the world. Now, things that, because of the diurnal cycle and were built that way, people have different abilities to do the work. So it would be very late for me, it might be like midnight or something, and I'm getting really exhausted and I just can't keep it together, but somebody else is just waking up at like 7 o'clock in the morning in Asia or something like that. There's all these exigencies. My wife was doing project management for HP with an international crew. She would be running video conferencing through their computers. Her team was scattered between Washington State, Mexico, Singapore, Ireland, and she'd have to be coordinating all these people, and some of them were just completely burnt out. And so I think that the idea of this web time is completely fallacious. I think it's a nice dream or it's a nice idea, but the fact is we're people, and we have these somatic requirements. And so the machinery is just simply going to have to deal with that. We're not going to be able to deal with the machinery. That's been proven time and time and time again.
This should be open for debate, because I do agree with the logic that it is the body that's dominant over the machine in most cases, especially when trying to get to the issue of time and diurnal cycles. But if you think of things like a virus, right? You've got a guy who's your specialist, your net specialist for your particular corporation, and the virus starts at 3 a.m., you know, I don't know, whatever, Tokyo time. Right. You don't stop it there. It spreads to half of Asia, or actually you can skip Asia, go to New York, and then back to Asia.
Yeah, right.
These are things that are working irregardless of what the human function or bodily needs are. These are kind of every particular operation is happening at this kind of scale. One of my, I have a really good friend from MIT who's in the mathematics department. He quit because he realized that he can beat the stock market. And this actually comes from this book, the James Blick book, After Chaos, which was called Faster. He thought that, well, we're just thinking too slow, right? And meaning that he was operating at femtoseconds, and he was working the stock market before it had, as things were changing, either the price of the various stock was going up or down, he was buying it and selling it while it was in motion, just like these kind of pictures. So everyone, you know, the stock was going down, he was there, before it actually clicked to say it's officially down, he would sell it. And he made computers that were operating faster than the stock market was able to do it. He made a fortune.
He made this
big freaking hedge fund. He's got a couple of billion dollars. They're still trying to figure out that, you know, is this a loophole or something? Yeah, it's a giant loophole.
By the way, the financial crisis was caused recently by a lot of computers that would start selling because they were getting mixed signals.
Yeah. That was only a crisis for about an hour.
Yeah, but even in an hour, the market's like worldwide spiraling. There was a record level drop.
Yeah.
So you realize how intricate this is.
And also, I mean, what I'm talking about, which is the exigencies of a somatic reference. I mean, we're humans. We live in meat space, you know.
Yeah.
The computers don't, and so that's why this kind of a virus can spread instantaneously, or this guy can make a machine think faster to do this because they don't live in our
continent. Would you say that one of the overarching themes of the 20th century, whether you're looking at the film Metropolis or whether you're looking at stuff like, I don't know, Terminator, was machines taking over, you know, or The Matrix or something like that? It's a major sort of myth of the 20th century. But the funny thing is with that was that the idea of the other, the machine always represents this idealized aspect of the relentless machine that is unbound, unconstrained by human norms. So the term robot comes from a Czech term, which means forced labor or unknown labor. And the first theater piece to use it was by this guy, Karel Čapek. He wrote, it's called Russell's Universal Robots. So one of the myths of that is that the robots are machines that were relentless, implacable, and just completely efficient. But if you really think about artificial intelligence, if you're thinking about, I don't know, everything from the idea of, what's it called, the singularity and stuff like that.
Yeah.
If a machine really attained artificial intelligence, why the hell would it want to mess around with human beings after a while? I'd get out of here. But it's the funny thing with the fear and the myth of the fear of machines is that they can displace these kinds of somatic rhythms and actually take over human functionality. Right. So whether it be Frankenstein, whether it be Metropolis, I can point out zillions of films that were huge blockbusters based on this sort of eerie mythology of loss of agency by humans. You know,
I would say that we become adaptive to the machine. So yes, we have these natural cycles, but we also now are like consuming mass amounts of vitamin D because we don't get enough sunlight. We have light boxes that we sit in front of because we have to get up early. So I think we will just find ways to, you know, adapt our rhythms to the machine. It's not the machine dictating to us that it needs us to be there. It's us addicted to the machine and wanting to, you know, it's like.
But even in a different way, I don't see the machine as any different, but it's an extension of us. It's taking certain human functionality and just idealizing it.
But I think we look at it as outside of us, like, oh, it's this scary thing. But it's us that's creating it. It's us that's catering to the nature. We like it. We like what it does. We like this globalization. We like, you know, this kind of connection. Mm-hmm. And at the same time, we're kind of petrified of it.
So I think there's two things you need to say about the machine, though, and that it's limited in two ways. Machine is limited both in the sense that it needs to be designed, created, and repaired by humans. And second, in the fact, if you get into quantum, that there actually is a smallest unit of time, which is the Planck second, 10 to the minus 31 second, I believe.
You can subdivide that. Anything that's divisible can be subdivided and divided again and again and again.
Yeah, but below Planck, you can't measure it.
Well, you'd be surprised. As new tools come aboard, new analytic methods, things that were recently, you know, unquantifiable are now all of a sudden just taken for granted. You know, stuff like that. There's always the way that the tools change and evolve, become more precise and more robust.
I'm more concerned about the mythology involved, which is that you were talking about how the machine is seen as this unrelenting, unremitting, unremorseful, da-da-da-da-da-da, which is an exact mirror of the ethical center of capitalism. Mm-hmm. And so, you know, because the corporation is unremitting, unrelenting, it's this giant machine that's just eating the planet.
It's meant to maximize value. You know, I mean, that's
right.
What...
Right.
I mean,
it still has that. I don't think we were born with this kind of... Well, I'm positive we weren't. No one ever said you have to be in bed by 11 p.m. and you've got to wake up by 8 a.m. because you got to be at work at 9 a.m. I mean, that, you know, I don't know what... I mean, I guess the Industrial Revolution made sure this was the norm and that we kind of... It's embedded in the way we think. But people are up at 4 in the morning. People, you know, would like to sleep in the middle of the day. These are kind of common things. There's actually an MIT project called Clocky. I don't know if you've ever seen it, but it's kind of this really beautiful researcher. No one was paying attention to her. She made this fuzzy clock that, when it rings, it's an alarm clock. When it rings, it rolls off your countertop and starts rolling around the room. You have to wake up and find the thing, capture it, and turn it off. It's supposed to get you out of bed. Everyone likes it. It is really whimsical. I couldn't stand it. I mean, I really liked her. She was, you know, genius, but it's like, what the hell is this? This isn't what we're put on Earth to think of these kinds of devices. Anyway, it became so popular. She's a gargantuan company from this thing. She's been on the cover of endless magazines, and she's making a fortune. She's on Jay Leno with Clocky. Everyone loves, fighting this kind of time. And this is in the same group that was doing the $100 laptop.
One laptop per time.
Yeah, for all indigent children.
So, with that said and done, let's take one more comment. That I wanted to kind of jump back to some of the issues that I definitely want. These are good tangential points, by the way. This is great stuff.
Just what you're saying that the Industrial Revolution sort of set time for us. But the thing is, before electricity, you wouldn't have really been up in the middle of the night. It would have been expensive to be burning oil or candles and things like that. So, once the sun went down, you had a little bit of time, but you didn't really do much.
Yeah, most cultures usually stop. So, with that said and done, one of the things that I wanted to abstract from the conversation we've taken from a couple of different angles is this idea, behind me you have a chart that Descartes drew to try and understand the idea of perception. And if you look at the Protestant work ethic of the last several centuries as one of the driving themes of capitalism, the idea of the Protestant theme, you know, whether you're Martin Luther putting your 95 or 96 theses on the wall, was that there needed to be a way to get people to get into the work functionality of their everyday life. So, all right, you get into heaven. God rewards you. You work hard. You're a peasant, the lord, or whatever. Feudalism, you know, you get that, right? Then we go to the Industrial Revolution, and you have William Blake with what they call the satanic mills of industrial progress. Everyone's being ground into dust. You know, the whole idea of the Protestant work ethic transforms what had been centuries of, you know, kind of work processes that the church had endorsed, and all sorts of stuff, whether you think about the divine right of kings, the production cycles of neo-feudalism, and so on. So mind-body dualism, Cartesian doubt. In philosophy, this was a huge revolution because there had always been this idea that there was a divine animation of the spirit of the world, that people were able to exist and create and have rational relationships to the phenomena around them precisely because God had set up the structure, and if anything was outside of that structure, it was considered a miracle. So if you see light at night, all of a sudden that's considered a divine inspiration. Or if you hear, you know, the Virgin Mary talking to you while you walk up a mountain or something. So Descartes, to me, is one of the first, Locke, Berkeley, you know, there's a lot of philosophical inquiry into doubt around this time period of the 18th and 19th century. Of course, the idea of reality, once you're at the end of the 19th century, with someone like Nietzsche saying God is dead, The philosophical underpinnings of capital and production processes that go into that really begin to crumble and have to be revised. People are trying to figure it out. And again, I'm always talking about this from the perspective of the arts. And so what ends up happening is you can see the loss of realism, literally, throughout the course of the last two centuries. People stopped painting realistically. Whether you're, you know, the painters were just the Impressionists are now the most expensive paintings ever made, and they're the most blurry. Their whole idea is that reality is this kind of slight blur. And that blur and that indecisiveness of imagery is one of the things that people treasure. But for centuries, the idea of like relentless pursuit of realism was what motivated painting. So if you go to the novel, on the other hand, and the way people are telling stories, and this is where I'm going to bring in David Shields. His book, Reality Hunger, is getting a lot of attention in a lot of theoretical circles right now. The New York Times, Michiko Kakutani, just wrote a huge review of it about the idea of what is realism in this era, where the idea of uncertainty of markets, uncertainty of environmental conditions, the uncertainty of whether or not global warming is happening, the age of uncertainty. You know, Europe and the idea of philosophical certainty really was the idea of the march of progress, that the world was getting better, that history had a finite and specific endpoint. If you look, you know, like Hegel, you know, there's this whole Hegelian dialectic of progress. Now Marx took that in another direction with the idea of dialectical realism, and then you have to say that that all these production processes end in this sort of utopian space. Now, also with Cartesian ideas around, you know, doubt, you realize that the human body is ontologically finite. We are subjects here on this planet in this time. There is no other time, supposedly. You know, forget purgatory, forget heaven, forget hell. We're here, it's now. Nietzsche really took that in a really different direction and said this whole idea that we need to have a culture that's continuously rejuvenating. And I'm going to bring this into the Nietzsche's dialogue with Wagner a little bit later. As a composer, Wagner came up with this term, the Gesamtkunstwerk, which was, again, a reflection of the time. Gesamtkunstwerk simply meant total artwork. And he was someone who was doing theater, architecture, projection with light, and he would, of course, make what they called a leitmotif, which is simply a kind of series of motifs that each character was assigned in his plays in theater. So Cartesian doubt, the next step is realism becomes doubtful as well. He felt that there was, if we're going to really follow the logic of all of this stuff, there's something, some strange force animating the world around us, I doubt it. And so he called this the daemon, D-A-E-M-O-N. And so the idea for Descartes, which became highly influential, was that we need to use science to understand better the phenomena of the natural world. So the interface between our ideas of the mind and the body and the dualism and all this kind of stuff became science is the grail that we use to kind of make the march of progress. So I'm going to draw this back into art a little bit later, but I saw somebody had their hand up for a second.
I just wanted to clarify, when you said the age of uncertainty, did you mean the age of indeterminacy?
I guess you could say, for example, one of my favorite composers, his name is John Cage, and he had this one piece called Indeterminacy, and that's considered one of his most deepest works and so on. The 20th century was, to me at least, if you look at the 21st versus 20th, like the overall theme was that science could solve everything. We had a mechanical structure to solve any problem. Everything was about an engineering problem, whether you're building a bridge or a nuclear bomb, or that, you know, we'd be able to stamp out various viruses. And once we realized towards the end of the 20th century that science isn't going to really solve everything, we need to figure this out. The oil well spill, for example, in the Gulf of Mexico, where they're trying all this stuff. Meanwhile, it was a multi-billion-dollar project at the edge of the deepest part of the world, which is, it's a great title, The Deep Water Horizon. And so I couldn't have made a better title for a short story. You know, but when you're talking about indeterminacy, John Cage, as a composer, he was inspired by stuff like the I Ching. He was trying to figure out, the West, a lot of classical music was coming out of this idea of Newtonian clockwork. If you listen to a lot of composers of the Baroque period, if you listen to stuff like Bach's Goldberg Variations and so on, there's a structure to the classical music that's meant to reflect a society in dynamic motion. But everything, all the parts mesh, all the systems mesh. There is no dissonance. All the music is really smooth and like seamless. You know, let me just play you Bach's Goldberg Variations, just to give you an idea. The soundtrack to this kind of psychology. Mitch, what do you think of that? Like Bach's Goldberg Variations, it's usually considered a classic reflection of high Baroque, early, you know, kind of critique of complexity. But I'm sure most of you guys have probably heard of Douglas Hofstadter. So just you'll hear this kind of modality that's very beautiful, but let's hear. Motifs, fit them seamlessly into a series of arranged, you know, plays on those modalities, and there's no dissonance, it's not noisy. Now, if you fast forward to the 20th century, the idea here is you have an extreme tension between repetition and dissonance. So you had composers like Eric Satie on one hand. Let me play you some of his stuff just so you have an idea of, again, like the early part of the 20th century when people are trying to figure out this idea of repetition. You can hear. That's the Grand from Marsalis interpretation. Let me just play you the other version. Subtle connection compositionally between Satie and the Goldberg variations, because a lot of his work was looking back at nostalgia. And by that time, the idea is that so many people had heard recordings of this certain material that nostalgia conditioned their response. So let's talk, let's play somebody else that was doing the same time period.
No one heard recordings back then, really.
Not recordings, I'm sorry, the written music. Okay. Symphony machines. Alright, so this is this crazy Russian guy who's doing some great stuff, but you can, this is around the same time period as when Satie is working. What I wanted to do is take the baton and then pass it forward into a marathon situation here. And because a lot of the issues we're going to be looking at are non-linear, one of the things that I wanted to kind of focus on first and foremost was clarification of a couple of terms that I like to call bullet points. And one or two of the things I was working on the other day, just to kind of recap notes for everyone, was the idea of pattern recognition being one of the kind of core elements of early 21st century aesthetics. And because pattern recognition, whether you're Google and you have search algorithms that sift through billions of you know, gigabytes of data, or whether you're an artist or a mathematician or scientist, being able to give structure to huge volumes of information is a crucial aspect of modern life. Yesterday, one of the other things me and Mitchell were talking about was this idea of perspective machines, from Euclid to Brunelleschi to even the idea of Cartesian logic. Now, how we put perspective together, how search algorithms structure the ideas and the way language interacts with the ideas that we make, well, those are things that I really try and kind of contextualize by saying that nature versus the artificial realm of human endeavor. What's the drawing point? What's the line dividing the two? Or in fact, are they divided at all? One could argue that anything humans do is natural because we're part of nature, and that nature is essentially, you know, beyond the human scale because we're just a component of it. You know, we're not the ones going around saying this universe is going to be like this and these atomic molecules are going to be like that. Although, amusingly enough, we're ascribing those to like godlike qualities. The creation of artificial life, the blasting of nuclear bombs, the hubris of these oil wells that are now being just, you know. They actually were saying they were thinking of a nuclear option. Have you been reading about that one?
Yeah,
they wanted to drop a nuclear bomb on the oil well.
The Russians recommend it.
Yeah.
They did it 5 times and it worked 4 times.
Yeah. Yeah, nuclear bomb off the coast of Alabama and Florida was really,
what could go wrong?
You know, so, I mean, you know, I'm sure you guys have heard of Dr. Strangelove, right? So, the pun here is that today I want to get everybody into this mentality of looking at art as the kind of elusive interface between the natural and the artificial. Art is something that human societies have always used to try and structure perception of divinity, of spirits in the air, or for that matter, how poetry and the idea of divine rights and all these kinds of historical motifs come home to roost. And so, to me, music is a mirror that we hold up to society. Music is never separate from society, and above all, the whole idea of art is something that is kind of a crucial thing to how society imagines itself.
Because geologists came by, and they had never done this in the field of geology. Controlled laboratory pours of lava, making it and studying it inside a lab. So he's working with all these geologists who are fascinated because they've always had a run on site while the volcanoes are erupting or something, you know, someplace in Hawaii, and start taking measurements. But now we've got the sculptor showing them how to use their medium. You know, I think that arts, have, for a very long time, have always kind of been learned from science and extracted their own kind of proposition, which is what some of these works are about, whether it's issues on time or issues on the industrial age or whatever kind of comment they want to make. It's certainly something that's in their own medium that they're kind of, you know, taking from another sphere of influence. So it was and of course, you know, science is learning the other way around. I kind of like the position where, you know, the artist, the craftsperson, kind of dominates the medium in the beginning.
And in fact, science and art, historically, they were always usually very much part of, that's why they called the natural arts or the natural sciences. But the good thing about what you were just talking about is that you have to imagine as society changes. Say, for example, in another era, he would have been considered a shaman. And, you know, if you're in Vanuatu, you had to sacrifice people to the volcano. Maybe he would have been like the guy who had better, precise, you know, kind of lava for you to sacrifice the virgins. So, I mean, the funny thing, for the reason I'm trying to give you guys these radically disparate points is, first and foremost, I like the comment I believe you had yesterday, like getting people to think more multidimensionally and connecting dots that not normally always be connected. Somebody had their hand up. Did you?
Yeah, I just wanted, you were talking about the relationship between art and science, just wanted to quote a funny example, which is the Dick Tracy watch phone. Remember that? And it was like, that was actually Dick Tracy's superpower. He was, you know, he was a crime fighter, but he didn't actually have any superpowers. All he had was this communication device where he could track the criminals and communicate with head office and that kind of thing, which is actually now something we have. You know, we have the cell phones, which are essentially the same size and do the same functions as Dick Tracy. That was his superpower.
No, it's a funny thing. I mean, a lot of the devices we're using now would be part of the myths of the previous age, you know. Like, whenever I see people walking down the street talking to themselves, you know, you're like, oops, it's not crazy, they're just using a Bluetooth application.
In San Francisco, they've been giving schizophrenics broken headsets, so this way they can walk around and mumble to themselves, and they're not rejected. So it integrates them.
Okay. Is that art therapy, device therapy? But,
well, we brought up, we brought up Freeman Dyson. Who was talking about Freeman Dyson? Yeah, Freeman Dyson. So this physicist in Princeton, probably the most respected guys from the Manhattan Project, who was talking about science fiction as being a very accurate economic forecaster. That when Dick Tracy has a kind of a watch that's also a walkie-talkie, something like that, this becomes embedded in our kind of desire, society-level desire. Like, we want this. Seeing Star Trek as a kid with, you know, these tricorders and communicating with people across globes or in space, this was a fantasy, but it was a strong desire line. It's very popular science fiction. The more popular it is, the more the science gets on board with actually making it so, the more society gets on board with wanting these things, the more business gets on board with actually moving in those particular directions.
There's a good book on that called The Dreams Our Stuff Is Made Of.
Mm-hmm. Yeah.
By Stevenson, some science fiction writer.
Or Thomas Dish.
My name is Dish.
But I think these are all valid points to point and to bring up. And I'm hoping to put these up here as provocations. And so I'm very into this idea that we're looking at Socratic dialogues today. And the idea is we're going to present work, we'll present some ideas, and then go into more and more tangents. So I'm going to move from this idea of Cartesian ideas of doubt and this idea of the ontological finite project of bringing human subjects to be the center of the situation, which is Nietzsche and so on. If we fast forward to, again, going back to the idea of the grid here, how many of you guys have heard of a gentleman by the name of Garrett A. Morgan? Anybody? All right, he's one of my favorite science guys.
I don't know you.
Okay, yeah, sure. there's two issues in him. One, he was one of the first black millionaires, and I think he's a great example of someone who was a very improvisational and innovative guy. He invented what we call the streetlight. Now, you have to imagine the American grid. Remember, I was saying yesterday the idea of how we organize American space-time using the grid. There's the orthogonal logic at play here. So one day he was on his way home in 1923, and he saw a Model T Ford car hit a horse carriage in the middle of an intersection. And basically, streets in American context weren't regulated. Cars, horse carriages, motorcycles, dogs would be running, you know, you name it. So there's this kind of chaos of ebb and flow going on, where nobody was really quite sure which direction they were going. It didn't matter. So by being able to divide up and give a sense of synchronicity and timing, and to give a sense of choreography to the landscape, you know, red, yellow, green, start, stop, slow down, he set up the system of what we now think of as the regulated traffic of every major city on the planet. So the street light gave a sense of choreography and pulse to the city. So if you ever see an American city from above, one of the most beautiful things is to see the streetlights go cascading down. Like if you're in LA or something, and you can really see, you realize the city has been put into this abstract sense of regular pulse and time. So when you look at traffic and you see people moving, it's kind of a choreography going on. They're dancing with these masses of movement. So the streetlight gave the sense of structured time to the city. The reason I'm bringing Garrett A. Morgan up is not only, like I was saying earlier, he's one of the first black billionaires. He made most of his money because he invented hair straightening cream. You can see these guys sort of Farnsworth, Bentley, their hair do going. But a lot of like white Jewish women and then black women who want to straighten their hair bought this hair straightening cream. But he also invented the gas mask, invented the firemen's, those full body coats that firemen wear to go into buildings and so on. So he was very competitive with Thomas Edison and so on. Really interesting, very clever guy. But the streetlight, if you think about the way the city would have operated before, just run it as an exercise in your mind. If you're walking through a city in maybe 1850, you know, you see horse carriages, people, right, maybe, you know, walking, maybe using all sorts of small, like, wheel carts, stuff like that. You fast forward to about 1890, the bicycles really kicked off. You know, bicycles start to proliferate everywhere. There's the electric trolley car. There's all these kinds of things that give structure to the city, but there's still not that sense of the timing and the pulse of the city. And if you fast forward to around 1914, when the war is kicked off and you realize you have this mass industrialization going on, one of the things that people noticed was that, like, moving large objects, if you had tanks, if you had all these kinds of stuff in the city, became very problematic because there was always masses of traffic, congestion, and bicycle, you know, all these different cars going off different directions. Just try and put yourself in that headspace, being in the middle of a downtown New York without traffic lights, you know, in 1914. So if you fast forward to 1923, when the streetlights have been, it was the killer app of the day. I mean, it really, people realized you can give structure to the city. You can be able to get a sense of timing and movement and choreography that allows the city to operate at a more efficient level of transportation. So it took off and then went global. And within 10 years, almost every major city then had, you know, the same thing would happen with other devices that he's generated, like the gas mask is incredibly important if you think about moving in hostile environments and so on. So, somebody, no? Okay. So, streetlight, choreography, we've gone from ontological doubt, realism, collage, how people represent the idea of nature versus artificial, the city, and structured time. So, going from the global grid from here, and then maybe some of these smaller kind of steps.
And there's a critique of streetlights that's being done in the Netherlands, where they're getting rid of all traffic regulation posted and streetlights, because they find that if you are forced to come to a corner and you don't know if you're going to get hit or you're going to hit somebody, you actually have to drive more carefully. And so they're finding that there's a reduction in pedestrian deaths in these towns where they're experimenting with this idea. So it's there's a critique of this too that's also very important, because this kind of system privileges the automobile, and it says what is efficient is the movement of an automobile at high speed through a city. Mm-hmm. Doesn't care about the people in the city, it doesn't care about the people driving across the street, the animals, or anything else. It just means you and your car having dominance over the landscape. And so the net result is people getting hit by cars and dying.
Yeah.
So the critique of this, which has been, as I said, going on in, like, I think that was maybe Denmark, is getting rid of a lot of these laws and structures to traffic, and which forces people to suddenly pay attention, because, hell, I could kill somebody. And suddenly you have to take responsibility.
This if they did that in New York, though, or in any major American city, it would be total chaos.
Well, yeah,
but this is the guy's name is John Gill.
I'm terrible with names, so I don't know.
It's absolutely right. I'll talk about this at length in the lecture tonight, because this definitely gets into my work. It's great to see the kind of the birth of this thinking comes from an individual like Garrett Morgan, which is something I did not know about.
Yeah, I didn't either, yeah.
Until I met Paul. There's certainly a lot of things happening, actually, even in New York, where we are slowing our streets down to make drivers not pay attention to the rules, but pay attention. And that's sharing the street with pedestrian spaces, or cafes, or islands. All these things as mechanisms or cushions to speed, slowing things down. So it's actually, Bloomberg was trying very hard to change the landscape of New York, and he decided, you know what, I have no budget, and this is impossible, so I'm just going to buy some paint. And in the middle of Broadway, we're going to paint an area green, some parts beige, and put some cheap planters down, and some really cheap chairs.
And ask people to have lunch.
Yeah, and people sit there and have lunch. Times Square is no longer Times Square as we know.
Yeah,
it's a pedestrian space. It's weird to be in Times Square because everyone is sitting around in these just painted street areas. And it's radically reduced traffic. The name of the person, I gave a talk with her and David Byrne. Some New York City planner has been doing this everywhere. I love it. But it works in a city like New York because it's extremely dense and 80% of the population does not own a vehicle. So we don't. Anybody coming in from Jersey, the last thing is give them the right way.
But at the same time, to triangulate between what you both are talking about, the whole notion of American, I think we're a culture that strives on this idea of individualism but still likes systems of compliance. You know, the quote-unquote rule of law, stuff like that. Even though, of course, if you're Bush and you can bomb Iraq, I mean, I just chuckle over the fact that if you're some kid that goes and snatches somebody's gold chain, like my girlfriend just got robbed the other day. It's a funny thing because I've never really been robbed. I got robbed once by the police in Russia. I was DJing in Rome, but that was under Boris Yeltsin. But it's like these kids came and snatched her purse, and I was like, okay, And so she called the police. Police randomly grabbed somebody because the guy was riding a bicycle, and they just randomly stopped a couple guys and body slammed them against the car and yelling at the guy. This is just a couple days ago. So I travel a lot, so I don't get a chance to catch up with her and see what's going on. But I can tell, it's just hectic. So if happens and you're some little kid that snatches somebody's gold, or purse or something, it's a misdemeanor or a crime. But if you're Bush and you snatch a whole country's oil field, then it's...
It's called bringing peace to the Middle East.
Yes. Yeah, and that's just the scale, we kind of... So... On one hand, it's punishable. On the other hand, it's the spoils of victory. But the funny thing is that we in America, we're a very scalable culture. I mean, we go from the micro to the macro, the small, extra large, medium, and so on. But with the arts, this is something I'm trying to invoke and use this as a provocation here, is that what made American art in the 20th century very robust, similar to Jackson Pollock doing the abstract expressionism, Andy Warhol doing these crazy copies of everything, Jeff Koons doing these kind of weird sculptures and so on, was that there was a kind of eruption of irreverence, even though it still fit within a very specific system of commerce. It didn't disrupt the system. In fact, it reinforced it. So the streetlight is a kind of a modifier of behavior, still within what you're talking about, but it's the problem with America, and the beautiful thing about it at the same time is it's very good at mass standardization, but it's bad at some of the smaller incremental things that someone like if you're a small town in Denmark, getting rid of this, it's a whole different, Like I can imagine Bloomberg doing the same thing in Denmark. It would just, or somebody, the scalability.
Well, you got the ideas from Europe because he travels so much. But, it requires a certain critical mass for them to be necessary even. Mm-hmm.
And I
actually. Beyond it there.
I would never eat lunch and sit in Times Square. It would drive me crazy. I'd find it a very unpleasant meal. Why the hell would you want to sit in the middle of Times Square
if you work in a building there? That's probably it. So,
it's a way of getting outside.
Yeah. I avoid Times Square like a plague. It's just totally.
But there is something about
you're talking about the rule of law and compliance. Societies will always find a way to comply with each other. So if you go to somewhere like Beirut, which is a huge city, and you've got tons of traffic lights, we consider kind of like Christmas tree decoration. They only run if electricity is running, and sometimes they're both green on opposite sides, and that doesn't really mean anything.
Right.
Even the traffic cop himself is usually would let two cars kind of crash into the other by just going like this. So you do have a rule of law. So if he's coming against traffic, and you know you can go up the sidewalk and then pass, you do that. It's fine. The society finds its own norms. Mm-hmm. When a society bases, Zizek has this piece on Russia saying that when the USSR fell, the biggest problem wasn't that it was a change of regime, was that it went from a structure that they've been so used to for so long to no structure. If you come from a situation where there is no structure, you create your own internal laws. So in the USSR, they had their own way of bribing people,
right,
which they understood. Which is why when the new government came in, it doesn't work, because there's no internalized structure yet for the society. So what happened is the Russian mafia, which was the old USSR, still applies the same bribe system. And people prefer it to the government because they understand it. If you come from a structure where there isn't a strong government, then you develop your own society structure, which is just a replacement.
Mm-hmm.
Your biggest collapse would be crossing the line, so taking New York to forcing it to develop something like Denmark or Beirut where it's really societal, or taking somewhere like Denmark or Beirut and installing kind of a very Germanic or very American kind of capitalist structured law system. That switch will always kind of create huge havoc with people.
And that's where you have this idea of either in industry we would call it innovative disruption,
yeah,
or in economic terms you have a production process that would revolutionize production to the point where it just causes total chaos for everybody else. Like, you know, one of the things, for example, when Chinese enter any market, they can underbid everybody because there's billions of Chinese and they can just lower the price to the point where if you can't compete, and so either you have to join them or you have to figure and just get out of that whole game. So like I've just been in Sudan for about 2 weeks before I got here, and you know, one of the things that blew my mind is it's a country under Sharia law, and the whole idea of enforcement and compliance, I mean, you're not allowed to dance so much, you know, because it's considered against certain creeds, and the whole idea of women socializing with men as well. So I threw a big concert in the middle of downtown Khartoum. We took over one of the central squares and set up a big sound system, and we got a waiver from the government saying that people could dance. And we projected it in Arabic. I'm going to show that later this afternoon, but it was amazing because people were nervous because there was a lot of security guys watching you, and they're enforcers. And in fact, in Saudi Arabia, a couple months ago, or maybe even a year, all-girls school burned down because the guardians wouldn't let the girls out because they didn't want unaccompanied women. So the whole school died. You remember reading about this? So it's that heavy. I mean, it's like, so anyway, we had women in burqas breakdancing. we had even the mukhabarat, those guys, they're like secret whatever. You never want to encounter them because they can just take you away and you just vanish and your body's found tortured 2 weeks later or something. So everybody was nervous because there's all these guys at AK-47 just watching. But then when they saw one or two kids just get up and dance a little bit, the circles would form around them and they were realizing that they were dancing in public space, and this tension dissolved and everybody started dancing. It became a big, you know, we had thousands of kids come out, free outdoor sound system in downtown Khartoum, which is, it's in the middle of a war zone. Genocides going on and stuff like that. But the whole pun here is when you're talking about societies finding norms, every society is an operating system. Don't be fooled. I mean, it's definitely got inputs and outputs. There is this idea of society as an abstract machine. Now, there's machines that, you know, function well, like if you're in Germany, or there's machines that might not function so well if you're in like California facing Arnold Schwarzenegger or something. It's terrible. But the pun is that these are all modifiable, and I definitely want to have people think about the idea of, when you talk about the imagination, when someone sees a science fiction film and an inventor wants to go make a tricorder, that spark is what we're talking about today, I think. So, say for example, with something like this, and the idea of digital literacy, These are some QR code prints I've been working on. They're algorithmically based. If you hold your cell phone up to it, it takes your phone to various musical motifs. And you can, the idea came to me while I was in Australia a little while ago. There's a friend of mine who's a composer named Bora Yu, who does cell phone concerts in Korea. And she asked the audience to all turn on their cell phones. And then you send a text message to this one number she projects. And then everybody in the room gets various ringtones. So if you turn on your phone and you have 600 people at a concert and everyone's phone is like having these little ringtones, it actually sounds very beautiful and kind of weird. So what I ended up doing was doing these QR prints where when people went into the museum installation, the whole installation was done in this kind of QR code so you could read the installation as data aesthetics. So there was encrypted images, encrypted material relating to the environment that we were working on. So this, by the way, is a map of this island called Nauru, which is in the middle of the South Pacific, and I spent several weeks there last year. But when you're talking about reading a text or thinking about a text, these kinds of prints, they're about certain kinds of legibility, and if so is a city. I think of the city as a legible script, and the idea of scripted space, the tension between private versus public space. Hip-hop was an eruption in that. If you think about graffiti, if you think about Robert Moses' idea of the Cross Bronx Expressway that disrupted so many local neighborhoods. There was a kind of entropic process that happened, and kids would then go out and take over the streets. They took electricity from the street lights and set up their own sound systems because all their normal social spaces had been destroyed. So their machinery of culture had been disrupted in a way that allowed them to actually have new innovation. So,
there's word out that there's a battle brewing between Run DMC and Special K and Kool Moe Dee. So I think I'm just gonna back out. Word.
1-2, 1-2. On the mic at this time, the coolest of the pool they call.
By the way, I just want to give you a little context. That's Vince Gallo right here at age 20, which is very funny. Kool Moe Dee. If you look at old school hip hop, it's very funny because the clothing that they're wearing is from different sections of their area. So you have the South Bronx, Queens. He's dressed like Michael Jackson with the sort of white glove. So just to, for New York, you can tell where different people are from different neighborhoods, different scenes, and so on. So you're seeing a neighborhood battle right here. It's just a very little heads up.
Homie Mo D in the place to be, Jam Master J. One for the trouble, two for the bank. Come on, Jam Master, let's rock the place. Ooh. I'm a dominator in my field. And when it comes to rap, I'm a rapper chill. When it comes to rap, I'm the epitome of me. A rapper fighter, let my title, it's Kool Moe Dee. They call me El Vanilla, the no one chiller. It's not Michael Jackson, man, this is not killer. One death rapper, Cole Long, and hey, I'm running around the MC like who cooler than your ass.
Well, I'm one.
This is a little contemporary thing. It's very funny when I see DMC. I'm producing stuff on his next album, and this is what he looks like now, just to give you a little context. We're just in Indonesia together. That's him. Right here. Right here. Well, you guys can't see. Yeah, that's DMC. I mean, we did a concert in Jakarta. So I always chuckle when you think about hip-hop and the idea of social space. Okay, so the production space, if you look at Lefebvre, you guys know this one, it's a classic text. When you think about social space, okay, coordinate points in a grid that no one really has seen because it's a social space, it's invisible. But what you're happening with digital media right now is you're able to demarcate based on people's choices, their playlists, their Facebook presence, the profile of MySpace, all this stuff is quantifiable based on choice selection, and above all, turning your interior, social choices about what defines you into data. Uh-huh.
Just to, on top of the Facebook thing, there was actually a recent study that was done in University of the States, can't remember the name. Anyway, the point was that people actually designed their choices around preset archetypes that were on Facebook pages.
Yeah.
So it was actually, it wasn't so much the choices that were dictating your personality so much as it was the infinite personality that dictated your choices.
Well, it's still original. It starts that pattern. So people are defining themselves at some point when these sets go live. Mm-hmm.
So that's still a social space, though. So what I'm sort of getting at here is that video you just saw, that was an MC battle where each of the guys was commenting on the other guy and the relationship to the crowd, whether you're the party rocker or the MC or this and that. Each of them was setting a tone through poetry. And the reason I started with Blood of a Poet and then was just showing you this hip-hop update of what's contemporary poetry is now how social space evolved. It, of course, in response to technological change, but above all, it's looking at how people improvise and create new forms of information about the information that defines the self. So there's a group of people that call this idea the second self, and it's meant to be a kind of a pun on how data can actually define the idea of a person. So your social security card, your credit card, your Facebook profile, all of these things are quantifiable material based on this idea of the second self. So in electronic music, one of the things that people realize first and foremost is the idea of style becomes a very crucial component. And we now are in a multi-billion dollar environment where style and how people create a sense of defining self, whether it be your clothing, your profile, your iTunes playlist, all of these things is now very abstract and very post-industrial. There's almost no production process of like a factory involved at all. So when I'm working on projects, I'll show you one last one just to give you, and then we probably should take maybe a 10-minute break or so. I've been working with Apple on a couple of projects around this idea of social tools for music. The idea was to turn the cell phone into a portable studio, but not just a portable studio that you're making and editing tracks. You're playing stuff in your favorite playlist, things that define your music taste, and you can easily edit, transform, send a link to a friend, and be able to, above all, like rock a party. So going from the turntables that you saw with, you know, Jam Master Jay and stuff like that to the 21st century, if I was to do the same thing, you know, just again, I'll just show you.
Now, there's word out that there's a battle brewing between Run DMC and Special K and Kumo D. So I think I'm just going to back out.
This is a performance, not a battle.
One, two, one, two.
Well, it's a battle.
All the right at this time, the coolest of the cool, they call me Mo-D. In the place to be, Jam Master J. One for the treble, two for the bank. Come on, Jam Master, let's rock play.
Okay, so you hear how he's doing the turntables to repeat a beat. Now, the funny thing is that beat is from Billy Squire, and it's called Big Beat. You guys know Billy Squire? He's very, you know, he's, yeah, very funny. But if I want to do the same thing, say for example, I'll just give you just a beat. Here we go, just for a second here. Alright, so you get the idea of being able to scratch, use a device that essentially back in that time period would have been an analog playback system. It's now become a digital tool that's dematerialized. So what I was just doing is showing you how a transfer process can happen from one social milieu into a digital media milieu. And what I've been doing is working on these ideas of apps as a dematerialization of the full process of what the milieu I'm coming out of, which is hip-hop, which is downtown New York, very specific regional. I mean, there's below 14th Street hip-hop, there's 42nd Street and above, there's the Harlem scene, there's the Queens scene, South Bronx, Brooklyn. At this point, Brooklyn is its own world. And Manhattan's a kind of gerontocracy at this point. But if I wanted to show you some other, just, you know, basic things here, like about beats and styles. Here's one where
Oh!
what I'm just doing right there is similar to what Jam Master Dave was doing with turntables, but I've dematerialized the turntables and turned them into software. So we've had this app project as, again, it's, for me it was an art project that's still related to commercial projects, and I work with radically different contexts on all sorts of stuff. So what I've been focusing on recently is thinking about how do you give people tools to be able to come up with new forms from old, devices that can absorb previous eras of functionality. Say, for example, if you have the phonograph and then this playback device becomes the equivalent of the phonograph, it has radically different material. But it still is teleologically related to the original. So what we did was try and figure out our mixing board collapses into turntables, turntables collapse into cell phone. Each of them becomes a kind of portable, abstract machine of the original version of what a phonograph would have been or a mix studio would have been. But it becomes functional, dispersed, and put completely through this idea of globalized networks. So the app store is this kind of eerie ecosystem. And let's just show you really quick. What I've done is basically turn a mixing board process. You can see quickly if you turn it on the side, you guys can probably see the scale. If I turn vertical, it goes like that. And the idea was to be able to give people elements, you know, bits and pieces of beats, drum rolls, sounds, and things that would kind of allow them to get straight into their own mixing and be able to share it with friends. So we've had over 1 million downloads of this, and it started mainly as a kind of a fun little quirky art project. And so considering it's about 11:40, do you guys want to do maybe a 10-minute break and when we come back we'll play more video clips?
Sure. That's funny. How would you respond to Adorno?
Oh, he didn't like jazz.
Yeah,
I have issues with that. How could anybody not like jazz?
He liked turntables.
He liked turntables. He wrote a series of essays about them, but the turntables would have to be playing like Wagner. I would take Wagner and scratch Wagner and I don't know, Eric B. Rakim or something. He would probably burst into flames. But
that's what happened to a lot of Jews around that.
I was just more interested in your issues about. I agree with you about his position on jazz. I felt absurd, but his ideas of
he was a purist. You know. Yeah. Jazz represented hybridity, wild new forms, you know, crazy after hours lifestyle, and he was very uptight. I definitely would have been into jazz in the 1920s and 30s. It probably was very cool to go to a jazz club in like Weimar Republic or Germany or something. But that's where all the most interesting stuff was going on, I think.
I agree with you, but what I like about Adorno though is his critique of music that reproduces the if not mimetically, then conceptually and figuratively the means of oppression in a capitalist system. So like that's what his critique of jazz was, is that it was repetitive and it was like mimetic of the machine and stuff like that.
Yeah, and it was American pop hybrid form that he felt would cheapen the idea of music and the idea of audio fidelity. All sorts of, his stuff about the long playing record and the opera, you know, the purity of how the voice would be carried, all that with the American music at the time, right? American music was an eruption of wildness and crazy progressions and, you know, just, the, you know, if you're hearing Charlie Parker, you know, but you know, you're Adorno, he would think it's the end of the world, you know, it's totally.
Well, he was interested in music technology for its own sake and how it could actually be productive. And as the editor of a, you know, some music journal in Vienna, I mean, he shifted the editorial program so that there were analytical essays to really discuss what potential there was. So maybe it wasn't like the potential that, you know, you like, but he saw their potential for it being creative.
No, I agree. But the reason why I haven't referenced him almost at all in this course, by the way, is that I felt that two things at hand. One, if you look at the Entasse Musik and the Entasse der Kunst movement, the German aesthetic of purism, really, of course Adorno would probably agree with me on this, but purism is always leads to very dark and strange places. And I think hybridity, on the other hand, leads to a celebration of new form, and you're always exploring and checking out stuff. I'm very suspicious of purism.
You suggest that Adorno's purism led to Nazi?
No, I'm not. I'm saying that the idea of purity, they hated each other. I mean,
of course,
totally
yeah.
Nazi. He wasn't a Nazi at all.
Yeah, Adorno fled Nazi Germany.
Half of the Jews' composers fled as well, not more than half, all of them. But what ends up happening, though, is that why he couldn't understand that Hitler's agenda of purity and being able to say that these are defined strategic areas of German culture that we need to celebrate and keep pure, like Wagner became the composer of the Third Reich and so on. I would like Adorno more if he said, okay, so if you're going to go for this purism and all this kind of stuff, then I'm going to celebrate the wildest counterpunch to that. You know, John Hartsfeld, you ever check out his collage? I wish that Adorno had been the equivalent of something like that, like celebrating the wilder music that Hitler, like, there was one moment where there was a German composer, Ernst Krenek, who did this piece called Johnny Spielt Auf, which was all Germans in blackface doing jazz. And Hitler was so incensed by this, he sent the brown shirts in to beat the actors on the stage and drag them in the street, and they were put in this public display of just horrible stuff. And let me just show you really quick before we take a vote.
If you time-base Adorno's parts of his theory, and one is the truth value of music and art as part of culture and revolution and teaching, and the other he goes into defining what is truth value and how can you make art powerful. That's where he talks about jazz. If Adorno was around right now, most likely he'd look at jazz as the way to actually teach truth value. You need to look at that with the timescape of where he was at that time.
Agreed.
It wasn't that jazz was, because of its music, non-purist, but it was part of the political and the cultural implication of different music.
That's what I'm saying. There is always a political context to how music functions, and I think people have a choice. They can say, I felt that Adorno, if you look at Heidegger, for example, he obviously has, I have issues with Heidegger in a radically different way than I do Adorno. But this idea of how this jazz was so disruptive of German ideal of purity that, again, they felt it was a black Jewish conspiracy to destroy the German soul. It was totally, they viewed it as the wildest thing. It was completely, like science fictional music coming out of an opera house or something.
The other thing is that Adorno was interested in the revolution. And you had to have a revolution now. Anything that got in the way was a problem. Mm-hmm. So I think his purism, as you described, is problematic because purism will run you down a railroad in that way. However, hybridity leads to aporia. Mm-hmm. So it's like you either get someplace with a purist thing and you end up with this kind of like Manichaean dyadic dualism, it's purism in this way, and you get someplace, or you're hybridic and all this kind of stuff, and you end up doing nothing. It's this swamp. These are the kind of the interesting problems we're faced with, because like your app now has to cope with what was Grusin talking about nowadays, pre-mediation, mm-hmm. where he had the remediation concept. Now he's working on a book called pre-mediation, where the systems are preset. So when you go to Facebook and you want to respond, you get to respond this way. Mm-hmm. You're not allowed inside that system. It's all pre-mediated. There's all these methods of communicate. So any kind of mediated communication comes with a pre-mediated structure. And so this...
But you could argue any communication needs a preset, a group of consensus to be able to communicate. If I'm using one vocabulary and you're using a whole different, unga boonga baga baga, neither of us will be able to communicate. There's got to be a structure in place that will always be able to find a middle ground. And that's where you
Adorno
get into.
Adorno presumed that.
What's that?
Adorno presumed that.
Right. But if you're looking at, I'm not, by the way, I'm not against Adorno. Oh. You know, I just have a critique of the whole jazz and popular music thing, but his theory on the long playing record is brilliant, other things are brilliant. But I'm annoyed by the jazz thing. I'm like, such a brilliant mind couldn't get jazz.
Yeah, I didn't get that either.
Yeah. But at the end of the day, though, every aspect of human communication implies a structure. I mean, this is where you get the idea of natural language, and there's a whole bunch of philosophy and what they call, you know, semiology and all sorts of, you know, things that go into that. So when you're talking about electronic music and abstracted rhythms and the way people, wherever I go, if I play house music, techno, hip hop, drum and bass, whatever, the audience will usually respond strictly to a 4/4 beat. It has to be in that, whether it's these kind of techno chords or if it's like hip hop turntablism or the globalized community, literally. And I've DJed in pretty much every, in fact, I've DJed in Antarctica and I'm DJing in the North Pole in September, so I've pretty much, I've been in a wide variety of social contexts. I mean, the 4/4 rhythm, for example, like that's where I'm trying to figure out a critique of the tyranny of that kind of form, like why 4/4? Why do audiences, whether it's rock, whether it's techno, whether it's hip hop, it helps them organize their bodily experiences to choreograph movement, to dance, to express joy, you name it. But it has to be in this annoying 4/4 rhythm. If you do 6/8, if you do 3/4, if you do other people, they're like, you know, they want the normal straight up beat. It's very Pavlovian. And why, you know? So that's, when we return, we're going to talk about this idea of standardization. And we'll, you know, just take a quick break, maybe 10 minutes.